Please welcome Director, Inclusion, Diversity, and Equity, AWS, LaDavia Drane.
Hello, I'm so excited to be here with you all today. This afternoon, we are going to be discussing corporate citizenship through the lens of leadership. And I'm really excited to introduce my panelists, starting with Greg Gill, President and CEO of SRO. Next, Noelle Abra, Associate Director of Biogen. Lauren Shanley, Chief of Staff of Pegasystems. And Gina Fratacangeli, Managing Director of Accenture. Welcome, everyone.
Good to be here.
So we're here today to talk about corporate citizenship, one topic that I know is very near and dear to many of you. It definitely is very near and dear to me as well. We've been living in really trying times over the last 2 years, and so corporate citizenship has become even more important now, it seems, than it ever has been, right? Racial reckoning, the global pandemic, so many things that we're facing. And so I'd love for you to talk a bit about this work at your organization. Talk to me about why it's important and what you're doing in corporate citizenship. We'll start with you, Greg.
Thank you. And I think it was one that in a sport that we were part of that was primarily always what I jokingly referred to as the League of Old Fat White Guys as running it. And that's what motorsports look like in North America. America was changing, but there was a real glacier slow pace. And with that reckoning, as you pointed out, and the pandemic, gave us an opportunity to really speak to what needed to be done. And we'd already seen it bubbling up, but it wasn't happening at the corporate level. And we were able to use the pandemic and that inward focus that it pushed on all of us to say, do we want to keep doing business the way we're doing, or do we want to take this opportunity to break things and make it better? And that's what it's been for us. And it gave us a chance that many people, and one of a good example is that we had one African-American team, and the driver told us, he said, well, I think I'm one of 10 African-Americans that's racing and involved in motorsports in North America, and it's really not much larger than that. We had had a conversation for several years, what could be done. We used that opportunity then to, by working with AWS and building a scholarship and then starting to build that, that's opened up, and then we could go from that kind of touch point or anchoring point, we could then go out into the community and address the community levels and underserved groups saying, you don't have to look like what you've seen traditionally in North American motorsports or global motorsports to be this way. Here's an opportunity for people. And we took a little bit of a rift off of all builders welcome and suggested all racers welcome.
Wow, that's amazing. And to think about the impact that SRO can have in communities that never had access to motorsport.
Yeah. Yes, indeed.
Awesome, thank you, Greg. How about you? Tell us a bit about what you all are doing and why it's even important to have a focus on corporate citizenship.
Yeah, so at Biogen, there's quite a few things that they're focusing on in different ways, but I think one of the things I'm most proud of is what they're doing around the environment and specifically to reduce carbon emissions and really take a lens of corporate citizenship around how pollution is impacting health equity. I think nothing became more clear than what we saw with COVID and different areas of pollution and how that actually impacted level of disease. So there's three major pillars that Biogen's really focused on. The first is really being carbon neutral, which they were able to achieve in 2014, but now they're pressing even further to that to challenge themselves even more by creating a fleet that is going to be completely renewable. As well as have their entire facilities powered by renewable sources. Next, they're partnering with Harvard and other academic medical centers to better understand health equity and the role that pollution can play and to really try to better understand and increase access for those people and why the lack of access is and pollution, the interconnectedness to that. And then also just empowering their employees. So really encouraging them in different incentive programs to also do their part to contribute to a cleaner future.
Very good, very good. Thank you so much, Noelle.
Yeah.
Lauren.
Yeah, well, first of all, thank you for having us, LaDavia. It's so good to be in a live audience again, and so great that so many sessions about IND and corporate citizenship. So I think when you look at how Pega's reacted to the last 2 years, it's kind of three phases. The first is this immediate reaction. You know, what do we need to do now to help the globe? And I'm very proud of the work we did with hospitals and healthcare providers to create a COVID tracing app that was able to help immediately and stand up in less than 7 days. And so that was our immediate reaction. And then I think you get into the, okay, now this is gonna go on for a little bit. How do we take care of our employees and their families? So we did a lot of COVID response, especially for our colleagues in India and the outbreak there, and just finding ways to engage all of our employees and make sure that we were listening to them. So we started doing a series called Check-In Chats, where we had an app that took feedback from our 6,000 employees and then had leadership answer questions and get really honest about it and get really honest about the response to ever-changing things that were happening in the globe. So that did a great job of kind of being our little bit longer term reaction. And now I think we're in this Zoom fatigue stage of the pandemic, right? We don't wanna do the happy hours anymore. We don't really wanna do some of the things that were part of that immediate or longer term reaction. So I think as we settle in now, I've been really proud of our work from our people team and from all of our employees to build our employee resource groups. So founding a Black at Pega, founding a Women at Pega, founding a Latinx at Pega, and being able to have those groups that continue what we started with the check-in chats, which is, how are you feeling? Just like you asked us, how are you feeling? And what can we do to make it better? And that's created some really great longer-term solutions that are gonna drive our strategy, you know, moving forward as we hopefully get to the end of this pandemic and then get to beyond the pandemic. So again, near-term and long-term, always kind of how we think about corporate citizenship. And I would never say I'm grateful for a pandemic, but I think it allowed us to stop and think about, you know, how do we wanna react to this as a company? To your point, do we wanna continue doing business as usual, or do we have this be a change point in how we think about how empathetic we are to our employees and to the world?
Thank you, Lauren. Thank you. Gina, what is the center doing in this area? Why is it important?
Yeah, it's an amazing effort with intention that Accenture is really putting out in the space. And I echo lots of the things that Lauren was saying in terms of the energies there. And if I reflect on when we think about overall corporate social responsibility is getting people involved and creating the opportunity for more and more people to get involved in so many different ways. So, you know, we have something similar to Pega with the employee resource groups where there's hundreds of different organizations supporting all different kinds of minority groups, all different kinds of special interest groups where they are run by the employees, getting involved by the employees, and creating the awareness and attention self-driven by the employees so that people want to participate, they want a sense of community. I would say during the pandemic, one of the hardest things was just getting that sense of community back. You know, Accenture has over 600,000 employees, and we had almost 100,000 people, new employees come on during the pandemic. Those people had no opportunity to meet people in person. So I think our intentional efforts around these resource groups really help create a sense of community for those folks and get everyone a sense of belonging. I think another thing that we're doing that I'm super proud of is just the continuous training on unconscious bias and helping everyone recognize some good, some bad, some neither good nor bad, but you have unconscious bias in everything you do. And recognizing that in yourself and in the teams and how you shape and form teams, and creating an environment where the recognition of those biases is understood and addressed, and making sure that as we think about each account team, each delivery team, we are with intention looking and making sure it's a diverse group of people. And I'm super proud of the efforts going into that and making sure, you know, having a female CEO who's making sure that there's efforts at every level in the organization at the hiring. I think this was one of the first years we had more women hired than men at the entry level, but then all the way through the promotion tracks, making sure that that is the diversity is so critical across all of our metrics and measurements.
You know, Gina, you used the word intentionality. Mm-hmm. And so I kind of want to sit there for a moment. Sure. Your organizations touch the globe, right? And I know that it's a challenge often to reach folks all over the world with these types of efforts. Can you talk a bit about that?
Sure, yes. It does not happen by itself. It happens with a ton of work and effort across the globe. And so I think we operate within the regions, but with some really specific international intentions. And one of the things I've been seeing, we saw in the Midwest, which is where I participate, was that we had such a lack of bringing women back into the marketplace, right? So we thought, what could we do and drive the efforts there? And we started something called the Mom Project, partnering with local organizations, going out into the market and saying, you may have gone and raised your children, how can we help you come back in? And getting them the training and helping them get cloud certifications, helping them get back up to speed. So we're spending a lot of time on the social responsibility, but then at the individual level, helping people find the opportunity to come back to Accenture. One other really special program that we are doing around the globe, and I think there's 1,200 people just in North America now, is a program to get non-traditional career paths. We're calling it the apprenticeship program. And again, going out to the communities where, yes, we go recruit at all the big colleges, but then spending time at junior colleges and recruiting people with intention, to train them, get them the cloud certifications, get them the latest and greatest training, and bring in a whole nother talent resource into the Accenture pool. So just two examples, but lots of exciting things happening all over the world that we're trying to find new ways and opportunities to bring in a diverse talent set.
Very good, very good. So we measure things often, especially in corporate America. I would love for you to talk a bit about the criteria that you use to measure these initiatives. How do we know that they're successful? Greg?
I think it's simple in the sense that we knew, as an example, organizationally, we had a ratio of just under 50% of women in senior management. So in one sense, we were comfortable, we thought that was a good area, but no people of color. So that we looked at that and said, we're a small organization, global footprint. We are participating in 5 continents. But until we have people of color in senior management, North America, we have 2 people. It's out of 12. It's still not where it needs to be. So it's a simple one of really meeting at our board level, saying these are our goals, where do we want to be, and then reporting back on a monthly basis, not a quarterly basis, but a monthly basis of how are we achieving those goals? Have we got the metrics in place? And then I think you made a really good point about non-traditional aspects. You don't just go through a normal recruiting firm. You've got to look into your network and then say, are we reaching people? Are we following the same way that we've done things? If we continue the same practices, we'll get the same results.
You know, Greg, you just said something that I think is worth putting a pin in. You said you literally looked around the table and you asked yourself, who's missing, yes, right? Something that's really simple that any of us can do, and you did that as just a simple principle from which to start. So just want to make sure we didn't gloss over that.
Thank you.
Yeah. Noelle.
Yeah, I think there's so many examples I could pull from, but I think I'll specifically talk about what I'm doing in strategic partnerships. So my area of focus is on the intersection of tech and healthcare, which is why I'm lucky enough to have the privilege to work with Amazon Web Services as well as Biogen, really looking to solve how can AI and technology, in the amount of data that's in all of these electronic medical records now, how can we use that to better address the needs of patients and fill those gaps of care? Specifically, better understanding social determinants of health, better understanding how we might be able to reach underserved communities, bringing patients in earlier, identifying them earlier, and I believe that the technology is there to do that. So we're really setting the standard, one, to challenge ourselves, to think differently about the way that we've perhaps been approaching these unmet needs, and then two, setting really lofty goals, if you will, on how are we doing? Was the algorithm successful? Were we able to identify what we were looking for in the patients that are being missed and left behind? And if not, why? And what can we learn? And even in those failures, to continue to charge ahead, because I believe it is the future.
You know, there's not that many things I can think of. They're more important than health equity, and you're doing that work, so thank you. Thank you. Lauren.
Yeah, so I'll talk about how we're doing it internally and then how we're doing it externally. So internally, we did an employee engagement survey, and we actually had 80% of our employees end up filling it out. Again, trying to get that feedback mechanism of what can we change, what do you like. The best that we got out of that, 90% of our employees felt that their managers cared about them and wanted them to succeed in their career. It was a great result, but then when you dig into it, we saw that there's not a lot of opportunities for internal mobility. Even though we increased our diverse hires by 300% last year, they were all external hires that we were bringing in. Because I think traditionally, at least for the decade I've been in software sales, it's been a pretty white, pretty male group around the table. And so we're not only looking at diverse hires as just women, which I think is always, you know, kind of the forefront is let's get more women there, but we're also looking at in terms of race, in terms of ableism, and in terms of, honestly, age. You know, I'm at the relatively middle ground of my career, and being able to have opportunities that let me move sideways and develop myself so that I can someday be an executive is really where we're starting to focus as an organization, is how do we give our internal hires the same amount of mobility opportunity as our external hires to get that diversity from the bottom up, up into the upper echelons of the company. So internally, that's how we're measuring it, and that's where we're focused on 2022. Now, if you look at externally, I'll tell a great story. I was in London last month visiting the UK Ministry of Defense. The Royal Navy and the Royal Air Force uses us for their recruiting tool. And the coolest story I heard was that they have actual sailors and actual chefs who are able to work on the PEGA projects because it's low code or no code. So they're no longer having to go to a 4-year college or a 2-year college or whatever to learn these coding language or get their master in computer science. They're actually able to learn how to code. And I think to your point, like that's how we get to some of those non-traditional populations is by giving them the opportunity to really dig into some of these tech projects. Tech isn't just for older or white or male counterparts, it's for everybody. Think of how many people use technology every day, how many people use the Amazon app every day. That's who you're trying to represent, and we need to represent that in our companies. And so being able to measure how many people are able to use and adopt our technology by being a no low-code platform is really important to us, seeing that reflected in our internal company as well.
Very good, very good. Thank you, Lauren. Gina, how are you all measuring success? Yep. What does your criteria look like?
I run sales, so metrics, metrics, metrics. I like numbers. I like holding people accountable. So Accenture's doing, I think, a great job of holding people accountable and holding management accountable. So everyone's metrics, if you are a manager, one of your metrics is the diversity numbers, and it is expected. And every manager, as they look at promotions, as they look at internal and external hirings, you know you're getting measured on that at the end of the year. And it's something that you're always thinking about and going out of your way, I think, intentionally to help find diverse candidates and not just find them, but help foster them once they're in the organization. What should you be doing to specifically help them grow, nurture, and get the skills and have the hard conversations with those people so that they can keep advancing and we're moving forward that way. The other thing is, as leaders, holding our people accountable when you know, when the teams come through and I have to approve if we're going to do or not do a deal, and I look at the deal team and who's going after the deal, I say, great, where are the women on your team? Well, we need this expert. No, let's start thinking about and start operating like a teaching hospital. That's a huge thing I'm trying to incorporate from a cultural standpoint, is this is a teaching hospital. So if you want the next level of talent to be getting skilled, you need to operate like residents and not medicine, what's it? but residents and stuff like that in a hospital where you've got a senior person helping that junior person and you're thinking out loud and teaching them. So holding people accountable to the metrics, but then holding yourself accountable to be, you know, specifically talking through how you can help them grow and learn and have the critical hard conversations.
So Gina, it sounds like you're data-driven, so I'm gonna actually have you set the bar for the next question.
Oh, no, I hope
talk to me a bit about how you're leveraging data to influence corporate citizenship programs across your organization, both internal and external systems.
Oh, wow, this is a good one. So data is everything in our organization right now, and tying everything back to the data is so critical. And I'll kind of flip it a little bit and answer it slightly differently, that you have to have the systems in place to be able to get the data. And step one is having your systems all talk to each other so you can get the data out of it so you can be making the decisions. So we've been spending a lot of time in the past getting the systems talking to one another so that we're getting the data out of it and so that we can make the assessments and understand what the metrics are. And we spend a lot of time helping our clients get to that point in the process too, whether it is the metrics on corporate and social responsibility or any other aspect of their business, is making sure we're able to pull that out. And step one is deploying the technology so that you can do it, I think.
Yeah, I learned early in my career, if you're not measuring it, you're not really paying attention to it, right? Okay, Lauren?
Not a priority, yep.
Talk to us a bit about how you leverage data.
Absolutely. Well, in terms of people data, our people team, which we call our HR team, I think HR got a negative connotation somewhere along the way, so people team. Make it a little more human. We obviously keep stats on everything, and we use our own systems to track. So we're looking not only and being reactive to what we're seeing, but we're also using our AI mechanisms to start being more predictive about it. So if you're bringing somebody in, what sort of path can they take? What positions are going to be ready for them in 2 years when they're ready to take their next step in their career? So we're using it on that side from an HR perspective. And then from a sales and marketing perspective, we look at it quarterly. It is part of our QBR metrics that we go through every quarter to talk about the team and talk about not only what does the team look like today, what are you doing actively in recruiting tomorrow, and then how are you thinking about where those people are? Who's the next person up? I always like to think, any Patriots fans in the audience? I'm not, but I'm from a Cambridge company, so I have to drop a Patriots reference. But Bill Belichick, who's the famed Patriots coach, who's won hundreds of Super Bowls at this point, he always says, who's the next man up? Who's the next player up? And so it's not only about having the next player up, but it's also making sure they're ready. So that data helps us take a step back and, like I said, say, what are we doing between now and the 2 years? If we are moving everybody up at the same time, how are we preparing them? So that's where we start using that AI and constant iteration of where are we today and where do we want to be tomorrow to really make sure that we're being proactive about it and not reactive.
I find that really exciting. So every employee, when they come in, they have a path, they have a plan that says within the next 2 years, this is where you should be.
That's what we're working on. It's not there completely yet. I'll be the first to say, that's something that was part of our employee engagement survey was career progression. So we're taking a full day out of our leadership agenda next week when we're on a retreat to talk about it and talk about how we build that out, because we certainly have it for the C-level, we have it for the level down, we're starting to get that next level down, but we found that there's a gap between that director level down that doesn't have that quite yet. And so that's our goal, is that we do want to have that by next year, that every employee that comes in knows exactly, and obviously, changes happen, things happen, passions change. Sure. So being able to accommodate for that too, but at least kind of mapping and planning to the plan. My boss always likes to say, prior prepper planning prevents, I don't know if I'm allowed to say this, but piss poor performance, the seven Ps. So that's our goal, is not only to look at that from a sales perspective, but also from a people perspective as well.
Well, I'm going to follow up with you on that. I think that is—
Absolutely, please do, hold us accountable.
Yes. Noelle.
So I'll just stick with my theme of health equity and what we're doing externally to leverage data to really increase access to underserved communities. I think a great example of that is a partnership, and this is really the ideal of what we strive for, with AWS and Us Against Alzheimer's, as well as Biogen, created a tool to that anyone can go online and access called Brain Guide. And the intention behind it was to reach underserved communities and just overall educate people on brain health. And if you think you might be at risk for Alzheimer's or mild cognitive impairment, you know, you can take an assessment. It will link you to resources in your local communities. And this launched last year, and it's been really great, but there's also been some really incredible learnings from it, just in the communities that we're trying to reach and perhaps, you know, not having a WhatsApp ability to access the platform was something that was overlooked. And like, oh yes, we should do that in the next iteration. But constantly striving, using the data that the patients are giving to really to continue to strive forward to break down those barriers and better understand what are the impediments to access. So it's been an exciting journey, but certainly, as you said, ongoing, and we're just continuing to strive towards it.
Very good. And Greg, from the CEO's perspective, right? So I'm sure you have folks on your team, they're gathering data, they're leveraging it when they're coming in and they're having conversations with you. Talk to us a bit about that. What do you expect?
I was so terrified you were actually going to put me on the spot and ask that question. because on the data side of our human aspect, we have done very little. We've been using AWS on the technology side, on storage side. We're heavily data-driven for what we do to balance the performance of automobiles, so there's a tremendous amount of data points and data being collected that way. But what we saw and we're looking forward to starting this year is as we go into communities and we're trying to reach underserved communities, both from an educational level and as a just fans coming to an event and learning that they're welcome at these events, is now doing demographic overlays into communities, and then there's some great data tools available that we can use that. So that's a next step for us, but like you guys said, a work in progress, and at the same token, something that we're looking forward to. So the next time we talk, I'll be able to give you good information on that.
Well, and Greg, you know, we actually have tools in AWS. We could build something for you, so let's talk.
We're counting on that.
Very good. Let me send this question to you, Greg. What are your three strategies for effectively measuring impact? So how do you know that it's really reaching deep into your organization, corporate citizenship?
I think we're doing some private surveys that are on deck now because, you know, again, you get into your own corporate echo chamber really easily. And it's, you know, earlier, and I think Greg expressed it in the group that was up on stage before us about that, being much more in a learning position versus a telling position in your management style. And that's been a big change for us because we'd had an autocratic style of, and then our measurement was really just, oh, bottom line looks good, everything must be right, then everyone must be happy because the bottom line was good. What we're trying to do now is find at a global level, we've done some sit-down times and talked about life-work balance, and in some cases, I think Europe is further ahead of us in terms of unplugging and working on that. So that's one of our first measurements is actually in some ways a negative, or can be perceived that way, which is, are we seeing less 2 a.m., 3 a.m. emails? And actually setting that up, today we had a conversation before we met here of stopping weekend emails. Now we're a weekend-based business, so we understand that weekend communications are very much part of it. But on the same token, if you're not on an event-based weekend, can we see the data that's showing us that the emails are not being sent and you're saving that for what, again, we to say that there's work hours, since most of us work remotely today, that's something we're trying to find a balance. We want people to be able to take their kids to school, pick their kids up from school, have a balance, have family meal time if that's important to them, and see that we're seeing actually for us a measurement of unplugged is going to be one of the first things that we're looking for. Are they unplugging? We found, starting with the CEO, unfortunately, people who were not taking vacation time. And are we seeing that work-life balance? Are you taking your vacation time? So again, pretty simple things, but ones that we see back are sending the message, you're valuable to the organization. We want to have your engagement and happiness has to be a balance to this, because happy people do produce better.
So the pandemic has completely flipped, right? How you're even measuring that impact. You're saying, I measure success by knowing that my people are unplugging. Not if they're plugging away, and Gina would probably say, what do your sales numbers look like? But you're saying actually unplugging, and you believe that that will then garner better results.
We've seen a record profitability for us in 2021. And I actually went back and asked my family and said, I believe I've worked less in 2021 in terms of total hours, screen time, et cetera, and measuring screen time, and yet we're having a higher profitability. So this work balance is, again, it's so common. We hear that term used and bannered about, but I'll speak to it from a personal level. If we don't measure that, and honestly, it starts at the executive level, if you're not setting that tone, again, we have such significant products that they're talking about. I'm involved in cars going fast in circles. The societal value of that, you could argue, is pretty limited. But the reality is it's entertainment. It's part of that. People want to participate in it. And on the same token, we can be just as engaged as a heavy engineering project. We have to look at this. If we're going to have fun and be selling an entertainment product, people who are enjoying and having fun produce a more exciting and fun product and ultimately profitable.
Wow. I hope CEOs are taking a page out of your book, or just business leaders in general. Really, really impressed. And you're thinking about it from a very personal perspective, which is awesome. Okay. So, Noelle, want to follow that up?
Yeah, so one of the things I've been most impressed with Biogen over the last year and a half that I've been at the organization is how they have a strong commitment to DE&I, but just not DE&I, the actual changing of the culture of the company, or maybe even just developing it further. And by that, I mean the engagement, which has been such a challenge with COVID. To your point, everyone's on Zoom. And you know, the fatigue of, okay, do I really want to jump on a Zoom call with this, you know, 30 minutes I have to spare to attend an employee resource group, you know, lecture. But they've done such creative ways to really draw people in. I mean, one of the biggest thrills, and I think this is going to be now forever streamed every year, is the Pride celebration that Biogen hosts. Really, you hear employees talking about it as though it were in person, honestly. And I live in San Francisco, and our Pride Parade is pretty fantastic, so that's saying a lot. But just different ways that you really are engaging people, coming together and bringing their entire self. So to your point, you know, really feeling comfortable to say, oh, I've got to drop my children off. I'm not going to be able to make that 8 a.m. Can I join at 8:30? Or, you know, just bringing their whole entire, you know, who they are as a person to work and feeling like they can and they're not going to be, you know, there's not going to be consequences to that, I think is a huge shift in the industry and something that is like really innate to the culture of Biogen. So that has really been a major focus of really looking back to the employees, saying how much engagement did we get in that event or in that space, and is this truly having impact on the culture? They also send out surveys after every single event and are extremely quick to address everything that's going on in the media, which is quite a lot these days. So I've been really impressed with just the responsiveness and how much they're investing in the mental health and well-being of their employees.
So feedback is a gift, and you ask your customers, your employees, to give you the feedback, and that's how you measure impact.
And then acting on it, I think, is the key. And that's when the true cultural change takes place.
That's right, action. Okay, Lauren, how do you all measure impact? It could be personal, or it could be a tool that you all use at Pega.
Yeah, you know, that's a scary question to ask in the midst of the great resignation. I think everyone, I don't think there's a company out there that's not experiencing, you know, a big kind of reckoning with people wanting to get more from their jobs because we're spending a lot of time here. To Greg's point, I didn't think I had spent more time working, and I was quickly told that was not the case. Over the last 2 years, I've actually worked more. So I talked a little bit about, you know, our HR tools and our quarterly reviews of what we're doing with our people, but you know, as a chief of staff, it's really my job to read between the lines of some of that data. And what we found is exactly, you know, Greg and Noel, what you've been talking about, which is the kind of the fluffier results behind the data, right? Are people happy at work? And two of the things that we found was, one, that Zoom or WebEx or any other of the million video tools out there, that fatigue is real. And so what we decided to do with the help of our executive team was decide that one Friday a month, we are going to do a no meeting Friday. And just give people the day to work, but not be on video, not be on back-to-back calls, have time to go to the bathroom, have time to grab a snack from the fridge, and just actually work and not just be stuck on these calls. I think there's a little bit of desperation, especially at a sales and marketing company, for that human interaction. And so we started booking, instead of running into somebody while you're grabbing a cup of coffee, we started booking meetings back to back to back. And so we just were able to give our employees back that day a month to say, you know what, you just turn your cameras off, get your work done, hop on a call if you need to, but that's you. So that went pretty well, and then what we started realizing was that people weren't taking vacations. They were working from another place. They would go to, you know, their house out in the mountains or take a vacation, but they'd still be dialing in for calls. So we ended up changing our policy and saying, when you are on vacation, here are the five commandments of going on vacation. And seriously, and the five commandments of going on vacation, you know, have somebody to reach out to if somebody's trying to reach you urgently. But guess what? We are in the healthcare business, but we're not the actual healthcare providers. Nothing is urgent. I come from a two-physician family. Nothing is urgent. They have real urgent business. So the email can wait, the phone call can wait. And just being able to create those five commandments, it is life-changing now when I send an email and I'll immediately get back two or three out of offices that say, you know, I'm out of office, this is who to reach out to. And it has done wonders for morale at our company, just being able to like factor in that happiness. So while we do have the data, we do have the numbers, it's starting to read between those lines that really becomes important as you think about corporate citizenship and taking care of your employees. And if you take care of your employees, they are happier and your customers are then happier too. So it's full circle there.
Very good examples. Thank you so much, Lauren. Gina, Accenture's large.
Yes.
Talk to us about it.
Yeah, I think our CEOs had probably been talking because some very similar things, right? Like on the Fridays during COVID, just trying to keep everyone, you know, I'm sure we're all in the same boat. Every conversation you had with your employees, everyone was facing so much trauma, a 360-degree kind of trauma with their clients, with their families, with their employees. So giving people the space to be, and we just started being truly human and took up a truly human campaign internally, and everyone in the kind of the managerial level, making sure you recognize a big part of your responsibility is to be truly human to your employees and make sure you're taking care of the whole person. And I don't know how everyone else felt, but that was a really big pivot for a big company like us, I think, where we thrive on getting out there, and everyone, there's kind of a badge of honor if you're working weekends and work, and to take the step back and let people know it's okay to do that. And I think for women especially, to be able to, your kids are running through the background on conversations, right? And that was treated as okay, and not that you're not good at your job or not doing your job. So I think helping everyone become attuned to treating each other as truly human was so critical during that phase. We also shifted a lot on those Fridays because, same thing, people weren't taking vacations. We actually mandated Fridays during the crux of it. You're taking Fridays off. Everyone's taking Fridays off unless you have client very specific stuff to do to try and get people taking their vacation and having a culture where people felt comfortable doing that. It's not a badge of honor to not do it. Coming back to the question you asked about the metrics, though, I think setting short-term and long-term metrics was something that was really critical to us as well. So while every manager has metrics as it ties to diversity, there's short-term metrics, and then hopefully people heard our CEO say by 2025, I want to be fully 50-50 diversity at every level of our organization. So yes, the lower levels happened faster, but how do we keep investing in women to make sure there's more women at the top of that pyramid? And what do we need to do today so that in 2025 that is possible and we can still keep growing at the exponential numbers that we're growing right now? So putting in the metrics at every managerial level that you're thinking about both the short-term and long-term impacts of a diverse workforce and all that entails, and then making the investments, like with the Mom Project, like with the apprenticeship programs, like with all the community outreach programs that we're doing, helping invest in female minority-run startups and doing that with intention around our Accenture Ventures and putting people in place to help those startups grow way early in the process. So something that I'm super passionate about is investing in female-run startups early in the process, and Accenture is investing in that and giving our employees a way to actually help on those clients. So we've allocated budget dollars so that consultants at different levels in the organization can spend time helping startups, help think about their business, help think about how our big clients would be interested in their product, and accelerate those startup investments. So we're thinking of some cool, fun stuff.
Talk to us a bit more about these short-term and long-term goals. I think that, so we definitely drive backwards from goals at AWS. And so we think about it as there's the input goals and then we have the output goals. But short-term versus long-term, that means there's a certain point in which you check. Have you reached the goal, that the more short-term goals, so that you can ultimately reach your long-term goals? Can you just talk a bit more about that?
Sure. You know, I'm thinking about again on the diversity hiring, because that's an easier one for us to think about and be able to track the numbers moving up or down. So all goes back to the metrics and looking at it from everything from the number of college level recruits we're bringing in to senior level recruits you're bringing in to managing director level recruits you're bringing in to ensuring that before anyone is hired, you've checked the box on making sure you've explored diverse candidates across the patch. So I think we're deploying tactics right now that that are tied to short-term metrics so that we can hit those long-term metrics. So I think we've spent a lot of time thinking about what that looks like. And one of the things is making sure we've got a diverse set of candidates and no one, whereas before you could say, oh, but this is a specialized resource and we need to hire yet another non-diverse candidate. No, you're not. Like, go hire different kinds of recruiters, go look in different markets, perhaps hire someone who isn't a textbook resume for that role, but we're going to have to put some time and energy and investment in repurposing them or helping them develop into it. So just thinking about it tactically. Yep.
Okay. Very good. Thank you so much, Gina.
Yep.
I'm going to go to Noelle next. And I really want you all to be as honest and as transparent as you possibly can, okay? What are some of your biggest challenges when it comes to this work? And you can talk about it from the lens of inclusion, diversity, and equity, or just in general, corporate citizenship. What are your biggest challenges?
Yeah, so I'll speak specifically to what I'm working on in strategic partnerships, because I think it's such a huge impact in terms of health equity and what we're striving to do at Biogen. But it's really incredible. We're very focused in the Alzheimer's space and really just trying to better understand the disease and the outreach to patients. And when you really start to dig into that patient population, you really start to see the healthcare inequities really, really striking. And what, at times it can almost be overwhelming to feel like maybe this isn't going to be solved. You know, we've gotten so far in cardiology, you're just watching oncology just explode. And then you just see Alzheimer's, which is equally impactful on level of population, but yet just really stagnant, not much growth and not much progress. So we just really take a step back to challenge ourselves to say, okay, let's just, to your point, let's make some short-term goals to try to see if we can better understand using technology and other innovative methods of why there is such inequities, and then really challenging ourselves to try to change that, which is hard. It's very, very hard. But we're slowly getting there, and I'm really excited. And so as hard as it can be every day to live in the space and kind of it almost, for lack of a better word, kind of watch the ageism that exists within this disease and just the lack of information in these patients that are suffering and continue to progress can be so heart-wrenching. But then to be able to take a step and say, wait, but maybe I might be able to make even the smallest impact to change that by better understanding why a patient, you know, in this certain zip code isn't getting to the physician's office until they're so progressed that there's nothing we can really do. Or to say, why is it that white men are getting, you know, diagnosed earlier, even though it's more prevalent in women? You know, all these things I think that the data as well as the science can provide, and then the tools that we can come together in our partnership to help solve for them. So again, it's kind of trying not to get too caught up in the day-to-day, because sometimes it can be really just so sad, but really realizing like it will happen. Every disease state has probably been in this place, and it is exciting to be at the forefront of really redefining care for such a large population of people.
Thank you, Noelle. Greg, what are the biggest challenges?
I think the an area, two things that jumped out to me in thinking about this is that first, we hadn't talked about the environmental aspect of what we do. And our founder of the company is in Europe, and he noted growing up, he had always skied in the same place, and as he saw, you know, a glacier receding over time, it became very clear to him, we have an issue. And then he looked at the business that we're in and said, then how can we move, when we're based in transportation, how can we move to carbon neutral? That became a, you know, it was almost a, are you kidding? You know, you're in motorsports. And but he took it very seriously and challenged us throughout the company to do it. So that was one, but the other aspect on the diversity aspect that was really, maybe I had my aha moment. I grew up in Santa Ana, California, very much a barrio community where I was in the minority in the community that I grew up in, and I was really comfortable within that dynamic. But I never saw it still what it was like to not be part of something. And for me in this motorsports, and Gene and I were talking about earlier about Indianapolis, and they have a very famous Indy 500 event, and it's the world's largest single day sporting event to this point with over 300,000 people in attendance. And I had gone to this event many, many times, but I'd never been in the community. And as I went around the community one day going to various post offices trying to get something done, I realized this is a completely non-white community and I had no idea. And I went to the, because of everything that had happened over the summer, I went to the president of the Speedway and I said, what are we gonna do about that? And he said, well, Greg, I'll tell you the challenge is that the community around us, if we go and knock on doors right now, they'll tell us they're not welcome at this facility. That broke my heart. And it also inspired me, and we agreed, and you know, thank you to AWS for being part of our first outreach this last year when we returned. But that's what keeps me up at night, and that's what is the push for me, because I think to like what you said, it's the same aspect. You see the challenge, you know you're working on the challenge, but sometimes you get so close to it, it breaks your heart, you know, mm-hmm. But you have to keep pushing. You cannot give up. Yeah. And what's great about this community that we're part of now is you see such an effort of smart people going all in and saying, we're gonna make a difference. So those two things are what really the big challenge, both for the environment and how can we leave something to our children's children, and in that same speech, can we have it to be different than their grandparents and great-grandparents' generation and what their expectations of acceptance and participation were.
True definition of inclusion. Mm. Very good. Gina, talk to us about your biggest challenges in this area.
Gosh, they're so big. No, I think the challenges are big, the challenges are real, and the challenges are going to keep evolving. So I would say, you know, me personally, what I think are the biggest challenges are keeping people motivated, laying out goals that are achievable, and keeping the engagement level going. A company like Accenture, we've got so many platforms that we're working on, right? We need to explain to companies how critical getting to cloud is for every aspect of their business. Companies need to understand how they need to be thinking about sustainability. And so the challenges, I think, are going to keep coming around social responsibility. And they're endless and limitless. And I think it's about keeping people passionate about it. And it all starts at the top. We've got a CEO who's incredibly passionate about women in leadership. She's incredibly passionate about sustainability. And letting the environment know that those things are critical to the leaders and they need to be critical to you. And keep empowering the people to be individuals who can contribute in whatever way they want to and are empowered to get together, form groups, and get out there and get missions. I think Accenture does a phenomenal job of allocating funds for internal organizations to be shaped and formed around issues that are critical to our employees and having a culture that fosters that level of creativity to fund those initiatives. So it's keeping everyone motivated and allowing for time in your day for that, right? We all get so busy and everyone has so much to accomplish every day. Having a leadership team who respects that and recognizes that that is an important retention for keeping the employees is that the things they're passionate about are recognized and valued by their leadership team and time allocated to them is warranted. So I think motivation and time is critical.
Yeah. Well, thank you so much, Gina. And Lauren, talk to us about challenges you have there at Pega.
Yeah, well, I think early in my career, I'll never forget this. I was at a conference much like this one and was calling it a night after a customer dinner, and one of my colleagues said to me, "Why are you calling it a night so early?" I said, "Oh, I'm going to this women's breakfast tomorrow morning." And he goes, "Oh, I didn't know you were one of those women." And I was like, "Oh my gosh, did I just, you know, software is an old boys club. I was early in my career, I was trying to impress my clients and my colleagues, and had I done something wrong by being included in these IND efforts?" And at the time, you know, this is almost a decade ago, at the time, it was really just women. That was the only IND thing, it was women. That really affected how I looked at IND for the next few years, and I really regret that, because I think the biggest challenge that I've had personally and that I've seen organizations go through is IND is not an other. It is a part of the work you do every day. It is not a separate call that you need to work on an IND project. It is not, that's why we've incorporated it into our QBRs. It's why we've incorporated it into every single all hands we do, every single check-in chat we do. Anytime the executive team reaches out to either our clients or our customers or our partners. And so I think that's the shift we've seen. That's an early challenge that I saw and a shift we've seen. But the real challenge comes from the fact that we don't know what any other individual is going through, right? Yes, I'm a diverse hire because I'm younger and I'm woman and I'm a woman. But I'm also straight. I know what it's like to be an LGBTQIA+ ally, but I don't know that experience and kind of hiding myself at work because I'm not publicly out. I don't know what it's like to be Black or Latino and be going through some of the experiences that you have being a race that's not white. I don't know what it's like to not be able to use my own 2 feet and be in a wheelchair as a paraplegic or be deaf. And so I think that's always the challenge with IND moving forward is we don't know what we don't know. We don't know other people's experiences. And I think what Pega is trying to do as a company is continue to get that feedback, but until we have those populations in our workforce, we're not getting that feedback. And so I think the reliance on our customers, the reliance on our partners to help us start to realize where those gaps are is really kind of the biggest challenge right now is how do we make sure that we're looking at everybody as an individual and understanding some of these individual experiences instead of the segmented group work that I've seen kind of progress throughout the last decade. You know, it was women at first, and now we've established some groups. We just did our veterans at Pega. ERG was just founded in honor of Veterans Day last week. So there's always gonna be this progression, but the challenge is being proactive about it instead of reactive. We shouldn't have our veterans come tell us that we need a veterans at Pega Group to support them. We should be looking at it and saying, we're there to support you. And so I'd say that's our greatest challenge today and something we're actively thinking about as we look forward.
And it's amazing how differently you see things when you put yourself in the shoes of someone else, right?
Absolutely.
And even the biggest challenge, the most challenging thing that you can't see or you can't understand actually going into that world, living in those shoes, even if it's only for a day, and then the type of impact that you then have. It's lasting, right? It's
exactly.
Sustainable.
Exactly.
It sticks with you.
People want that empathy, and it's ironic because we sell software that targets an individual instead of a segment, and that's how we should be treating everybody. Everyone's an individual. There's no longer this segmentation in the world.
Love it. Well, as we close our session, I do have one last question for you all. I want you to think big. So it's one of our leadership principles at Amazon. And I want you to think about big impact. We've used that word a couple of times during the session. Big results, right? If funding was no object, if time wasn't a challenge, Gene, I think you talked a bit about time earlier. What would you do now to improve corporate citizenship efforts at your organization? Think big. Who wants to start?
I can go ahead. So we formed 4 IND work streams at the beginning of this year and had over 100 employees volunteer to serve on them. Again, coming back to that, it's part of your work idea. We founded something called DIG Days, Development, Inclusion, and Growth Days. Fun little acronym, software. We love our acronyms. And so we're piloting that program right now in this quarter. And basically what it is every employee gets to take a single day off, no questions asked, single day off a quarter, every quarter, to work on something related to their development, inclusion, and growth. Fantastic. I'm using mine this week to sit in on some of these sessions, and we are doing readouts of what we've learned with our teams, and our leadership team is going to be sharing what they use theirs for in a few weeks here. But if I was to think about money and time, I'd give everybody like 2 weeks to go do it and whatever they wanted to go do and fund it all. Right, you know, right now it can be as simple as taking a LinkedIn learning or, you know, taking a class or reading a book that you've wanted to read and focusing on something yourself. But that's where I'd open it up to, is giving every employee, you know, 2 weeks or even a month if we're talking really crazy, to go really identify something that they can dig into and come back. It comes back to the LaDavia, to what I was talking about with the 2-year plan, like taking time to think about your 2-year plan. So that's where I'd go with it. It doesn't sound like much, but I can't imagine how much impact it would have to give people that time to really think about what they wanted and how they could be better as not only a corporate citizen, but as a citizen of the world.
Thank you. Thank you so much. Gina?
Sure. We have started something called, it's once a month. It sounds great doing it once a week. I love that. But once a month, every Friday, within each one of the markets, they get together. And we were calling it before Brave the Future, now trying to get through COVID. And now it's called the Next Generation Sessions. And it is the opportunity where we don't really talk about kind of the technical stuff of our work, but there's a whole day of programming tied to community involvement, tied to different aspects of the various ERGs within the organization, whether it's, you know, the cycling club or Tai Chi or going out and doing community service activities, but in every local office, which is what I love, because everyone typically in our universe goes out and our consultants and kind of pre-COVID would get on an airplane, go away. This is something to try and create that community involvement so people get to know each other at the local level across functions. So technology people, getting to meet interactive people, et cetera, et cetera. But if you pose the challenge, which I love, and if it was, you know, how could we think bigger? How could we think about it? It would be, you know, encouraging everyone to get down to the one-on-one level. And so partnering and ensuring that senior people are paired with junior people and not necessarily like a professional mentoring experience, but a relationship building experience. And so you got me thinking about that kind of on the fly of what we could do. So good job. How we could expand that, because I think it is something as we all work at big companies and having the opportunity to meet more people and build those relationships. So yeah, something to think about.
Thank you. Thank you, Gina. Noelle?
So I've been really impressed with the work that our CEO, as well as our US president, has done in empowering women and really promoting them and just the true investment in DE&I, like I had spoken to, really reflecting in the actions. And I think one of the things that
you know, I've been most impressed with coming out of COVID is the way that they have pivoted in definition of work-life balance or where you can work. So I am a San Francisco-based employee, but I'm technically a home office employee, but I live in San Francisco, and I come to the office when needed, and that office is in Boston. And really everything is kind of as it fits the needs of the business and the needs of our team, as well as majority of the people on my team are also now considered what is defined as hybrid. So if I think about what kind of barriers that breaks down for women specifically and men and people with young kids and people who are living in different areas. I mean, I think this is how we continue to access and open opportunities to all types of people. So if I had all the time and money, I would really invest in that idea and like what else is possible. I mean, I think that COVID redefined work for everyone. And so now we're starting from a different baseline. So I often think, what else is there? How else can we continue to flex and support others to even continue to grow the diversity of our workforce to be able to include everyone? So that would be the area that I would continue to really invest in.
Thank you, Noelle. Greg, bring us home.
I think the word, and I was listening to everybody, the word that came to my mind was more. And I wish that in that, you know, money and time were no limits, then there would be opportunities for full scholarship for anybody who wished to participate with us, because there is a tremendous barrier on cost of participation, education, and opportunity. And the same way for people that we can reach into more communities. That would be just more to wrap it up.
Well, look to us in AWS as a partner. For these think big ideas, I would love to see them actually happen. And we'd love to partner with you in order to make it a reality. So with that, we're gonna wrap up our session. Thank you all so much for being here with us. Those that are with us virtually, those that are with us in person, believe it or not, we're looking out at people in an audience. Gina, Lauren, Noelle, Greg, it's been amazing to have this conversation with you, and look forward to the awesome corporate citizenship work that your organizations will continue to do, and so impressed with the things that you're doing now. Thank you.
Thank you.